हेलो फ्रेंड्स, वेलकम टू द वीडियो सीरीज ऑफ साइंस सेकंड फॉर स्टैंडर्ड 10th एंड वी आर गोइंग टू स्टार्ट हियर सेकंड चैप्टर लाइफ प्रोसेसेस इन लिविंग ऑर्गेनिजम्स पार्ट 1. व्हाट यू आर गोइंग टू लर्न इन दिस चैप्टर हियर 3 मेन पार्ट्स आर देयर इन दिस चैप्टर. 1, यू विल बी एबल टू लर्न अबाउट द फूड कंपोनेंट्स. 2, energy production, and 3rd one, cell division, which is the important life process in all the living organisms. So let's start with first part of this chapter, that is food components. Okay, now you may be able to see some pictures here. These are the very few pictures, but they represent the daily activities which a person is doing in the life. So, we are eating, we are walking, running, we are playing, we are working. All these activities are performed, and for performing all these activities, we have a special system in our body. Digestive system is there. When we are eating the food, for the digestion of the food, digestive system is there. We are breathing. For inhaling oxygen, we have respiratory system. Waste products to remove from the body, we have excretory system. Circulatory system is there in our body, which supplies necessary nutrients and substances to each cell. Then, like that way, we have many systems in our body. The main control of our body is done with the nervous system, correct? So, like that way, other various systems are there in our body, which works in harmony, which works in coordination, so that all our activities will be going on very smoothly. But how do these activities are done? For doing all these activities, we need energy. So from where do we get energy? Of course, the food which we eat gives us energy. So when we are eating food, what do we eat? When we eat food, what is such a substance or such a compounds we are getting from food that it is used for the production of the energy which is required for our body? They are nothing but the simply our food constituents. So which are the components or constituents of the food? Just to recall what you have learned in the previous classes. Yes, I think answer is there in your mind. We eat carbohydrates, we eat proteins, fats or lipids, and we have some intake of vitamins and minerals also. Okay, so here all these food components are used to get energy for our body. Out of this, 3 macromolecules are there and the other 2 are micromolecules. Macromolecules means bigger molecules, like carbohydrates are there, proteins are there, fats or lipids are there. And micromolecules means vitamins and minerals are there. Micromolecules are required very less quantity to our body, and macromolecules are required in bigger quantity to our body. So let's start first with carbohydrates. So as you have studied in the previous classes also, everybody knows we get energy, a lot of energy from carbohydrates. Then what happens to the carbohydrates when they enter in our digestive system? So when carbohydrates are entered in our digestive system, means when we consume carbohydrates, then carbohydrates are converted to glucose. Carbohydrates are the complex molecules which are insoluble in water, so insoluble in blood. So, in digestion process, enzymes are acting on it, digestive juices are acting on it, and carbohydrates are converted to simple substances like glucose. And glucose can dissolve in water or glucose can dissolve in blood. Like that way, glucose can be taken to each cell of our body. Now, which are the food items from which we can get carbohydrates? They are all type of cereals, from milk, jaggery, sugar, cane sugar, many fruits, and some of the vegetables like potato, sweet potato, and sweet meats are there, like this may all the sweet items are there, they are giving us carbohydrates because they are made from most of the food items, like all the sweet dishes are there, they are made up of cereals. So we can say that cereals are the main substances, foodstuffs from which we get carbohydrates. Now how much calorie of energy we get from per gram of carbohydrate? That is 4 kilocalorie. We get 4 kilocalorie of energy per gram of carbohydrate. Now suppose extra carbohydrate is there in your body, then what happens to that? If extra carbohydrate is there in your body, means extra glucose is there in your body, then it is stored in the form of glycogen in the liver cells as well as muscle cells. And when your intake of carbohydrate is less, then that glycogen is used for production of energy. So this is about carbohydrates. Let's come to the next food component, that is protein. So what are proteins? Proteins are the macromolecules which are formed by the bonding between the amino acids by peptide bond. Now proteins are useful for growth of the body, healing of the body, wear and tear of the body. It means all the emaciation is done to the body that can be cleared with the help of, or that can be cured with the help of proteins. Now as you are knowing, milk is giving us protein, eggs are giving us proteins, and all the non-veg food, whatever you are eating, they give us, they are very highly rich in proteins. So other than this, means non-veg, that is animal source, the protein which we get from animal source, that is called first class protein. So those who are non-vegetarians, means those who are non-vegetarians, they will get first class protein whatever they eat non-veg food. But what about vegetarian people? How do they get proteins? They will also get protein by eating all the type of pulses, milk, etc. So like that way, the protein intake for our body is also very necessary for the growth. We get 4 kilocalorie of the energy from per gram of protein. When protein is excess in our body, it is not stored in the body, but it is converted to. Now proteins are the complex molecule. In the digestion process, they are converted to amino acids. And if excess of amino acids are there in our body, excess of proteins are there in our body, then they are converted to ammonia and are given out of the body. So excess of protein are not stored in our body. That's why every day we should have some intake of protein properly. Now, next food constituent is there, that is fats or lipids. Fats we get from the fatty substances, what we say. Fats in the digestion are converted to fatty acids. And what is the use of fatty acids? That fats also give us energy. 9 kilocalorie of energy we get per gram of fats or lipids. Now fats and lipids, they are exactly not same, but they are in the same category. So whether we say fats or lipids, they are the as a food constituent, it is considered same. When lipids are digested, they give us alcohol and fatty acids. It means lipids are made up of alcohol and fatty acids molecule. So here various type of lipids are there which are helpful for our body. Let's see what are the uses of lipids. Phospholipids are useful for producing plasma membrane in our body. Lipids are used for producing the hormones like estrogen, testosterone, aldosterone in our body, as well as the covering of the axon of the nerve cells is also made up of fatty acids. So like that way, there is use of various other uses are there of this fatty acid, fats or lipids, or we say fatty acids. And excess of fatty acids are there, or fat is there in our body, it is stored in our adipose connective tissue. Macromolecules which are necessary for our body. And next are micromolecules, vitamins and minerals. A, B, C, D, E and K. 6 type of vitamins we are needed for our body. And the various minerals are there. They are also very, very much useful for our body. So A, D, E and K are fat soluble vitamins and B and C are water soluble vitamin. They need for our body in very less quantity but are very useful. Let's see in the chart what are the sources of these vitamins and what are the deficiency diseases caused due to these vitamins or minerals. Other than carbohydrate, protein, fats, vitamins or minerals, water and fibrous food or fiber is also very important for our body. It is necessary for our body. Water is 65 to 70% by weight of a body we have, and as you know, the blood is also 90% of water. Therefore, water is very important one. If this percentage of water goes down, then it is called dehydration. And in that, then minerals which are present in the water, dissolved condition, they also become less. And so, we may have some disorder in our body. For that purpose, to get this recovering of the water level, a oral rehydration solution is given, which is made up of salt, sugar and water. So, water is very important, which keeps our body hydrated. If we keep our body hydrated, then all the cells are hydrated and then the skin is also good and all the metabolism in the body is also carried out very smoothly. The next one is fiber. The fiber is not, we cannot consider it as a foodstuff or the component of the food, because it is not digested in our body or it is not helpful for our body to get any nutrient, but it helps for the digestion of all these food components, and therefore fiber is also one of the important part of our diet. So if we have carbohydrates, protein, fats, vitamins, minerals, fiber, like that, some all the food we are eating, then we are eating a balanced food or we are taking balanced diet. So, balanced diet is very important for our body. Now, let's see how energy is produced. Because when we are eating foodstuffs, carbohydrate, protein or fats, these are going to use for the energy production. So, let's see how the energy is produced with the help of these carbohydrates or proteins or fats. We consume carbohydrates through our food. Then carbohydrates are converted to glucose. So our digestive system is providing us glucose by digestion process. We have respiratory system in which we get oxygen from the air. Glucose and oxygen, they are the raw materials for the production of energy. So they are both very necessary constituents, or they are the necessary components for the energy production. Now, every living organism has a special system of energy production. There are different steps for the energy production. First of all, try to understand respiration. What is respiration? Respiration is, we can say it is two-step process, internal respiration and external respiration. External respiration, when we say, when we breathe air or when we breathe oxygen and when we exhale carbon dioxide, that is the process called breathing. It is external respiration. The oxygen which we have taken in our body, that is utilized by the body for the production of energy, and this is called as internal respiration. Internal respiration takes place in the cells, so it is called as cellular respiration. So, cellular respiration is nothing but the production of energy. So, when we say respiration, it is exchange of the gases and production of energy in our body. All living organisms, energy is produced in their body. But there are two types of respirations. One is aerobic respiration and the other is anaerobic respiration. Aerobic respiration means with the presence of oxygen. Anaerobic respiration means with the absence of oxygen or lack of oxygen. So most of the higher plants and animals, they perform aerobic respiration, but sometimes they can perform anaerobic respiration also. And all the microorganisms, they perform anaerobic respiration. Now, aerobic respiration has three main steps where glucose is oxidized step by step. And that three steps are glycolysis, tricarboxylic acid cycle, and electron transport chain reaction. Let's see one by one. Let's try to understand what is meant by glycolysis. Now, glycolysis is actually splitting of sugar. A 6-carbon compound is broken down to 3-carbon compound, that is called pyruvic acid or pyruvate. This process, it takes place in the cytoplasm and it is called as glycolysis. In the glycolysis, along with 2 molecules of pyruvic acid, 2 molecules of ATP, 2 molecules of NADH2 and 2 molecules of water are formed. Now here, just keep in mind, carbon dioxide is not formed in this process of or the first step of glycolysis. Glycolysis is the common or the compulsory step for aerobic respiration as well as anaerobic respiration. So this pyruvic acid which is formed in glycolysis is further converted to acetyl coenzyme A. This NADH2 molecule is an enzyme which carries electron, so that the third step, electron transfer chain reaction, it will be useful. Acetyl coenzyme A is there which enters in the second step, and from that the ATP molecules are produced, or NADH2, FADH2 molecules are produced. Two molecules of pyruvic acid are converted to acetyl coenzyme A, two molecules of NADH2, then two molecules of CO2 are released in this process. Keep in mind, in glycolysis, means along with the formation of the pyruvic acid, carbon dioxide is not given out. When the formation of pyruvic acid takes place, that is 6-carbon compound is converted to 3-carbon compound, there glycolysis is over. Now the next step will start. For that purpose, the next step will start with acetyl coenzyme A. Acetyl coenzyme A is formed from pyruvic acid. Along with that, NADH2 and carbon dioxide molecules are produced. The next step is tricarboxylic acid cycle. In this tricarboxylic acid cycle, it is in short also called TCA cycle, or it is also called citric acid cycle, because in this cycle 10 reactions are there. The 10 reactions are completed here, and the acetyl part of this acetyl coenzyme A is completely oxidized. And the first product which is formed in this reactions, that is citric acid. So this cycle is also called as citric acid cycle. And as it is discovered by Sir Hans Krebs, so it is also called Krebs cycle. If you have in your mind what is this NADH2, FADH2, ATP, so let's see their full forms. In the oxidation of acetyl part of this acetyl coenzyme A, molecules of carbon dioxide, molecules of water, NADH2 and FADH2 are produced. Then whatever NADH2 and FADH2 are produced, these enzymes, they enter in the next step, that is electron transfer chain reaction. Glycolysis takes place in cytoplasm, TCA cycle takes place in mitochondria, and electron transfer chain reaction, that also takes place in mitochondria. So let's see electron transfer chain reaction. Now oxidation, if you have learned in chemistry, oxidation means loss of electron. So by the loss of electron from NADH, this NADH2 and FADH2, they are carrying out this electrons, and from that, with the help of enzymes, NADH2 and FADH2 molecules are converted to ATP molecules, which are called as energy currency of the cell. This, from the one molecule of NADH2, we can get 3 molecules of ATP, and one molecule of FADH2 gives two molecules of ATP. And the energy which is stored in the phosphate bond, that is when phosphate bond is broken down, we get energy. Like that way, in the whole process, 38 ATP molecules are formed from one molecule of glucose. So such a way, very high energy is formed, and that's why if in aerobic respiration, a good quantity of energy is produced from the molecules of glucose. If there is less quantity of carbohydrate in our body, then proteins and lipids are also used for the energy production. Proteins are converted to amino acids. Fats or lipids are converted to fatty acids. So, in place of glycolysis, direct production of acetyl coenzyme A will be there from amino acids and fatty acids. So, acetyl coenzyme A, then it will enter into Krebs cycle, and then electron transfer chain reaction will be there and ATP molecules will be produced. So, this was aerobic respiration. Anaerobic respiration takes place in the absence of oxygen or lack of oxygen. So, we say that incomplete oxidation takes place in anaerobic respiration. Then, who performs anaerobic respiration? The higher plants and animals, they perform anaerobic respiration in certain conditions. And usually microorganisms, they perform, which are not able to survive in oxygen, they perform anaerobic respiration. Anaerobic respiration example, if you see the seeds, when they are submerged in the water, they do this anaerobic respiration. When we do a lot of exercise, that time our muscle cells are depleted with the oxygen level, and at that time our muscle cells also do anaerobic respiration. Then what are the products formed in anaerobic respiration? Different products are formed in the different organisms. So when we do exercise in our body, when there is depletion of the oxygen in some of the muscle cell, in some part of our muscle body, that time anaerobic respiration is carried out, and instead of good number of ATP molecules, very less number of ATP molecules are produced, and lactic acid is also produced. Lactic acid accumulates in our muscle cells and it causes a sensation of the pain, or we feel tired. So anaerobic respiration, there are two main steps. First is the glycolysis and second is the fermentation. In the fermentation, mainly suppose the fermentation is carried out by the microorganism. For example, in yeast, it is used in the bakery industry. For what is the main aim of using this yeast? Fermentation. Fermentation, what is the main product needed? That is carbon dioxide. So when fermentation is carried out by yeast, then that is anaerobic respiration, when it is carried out by yeast, then it produces alcohol and carbon dioxide. Erythrocytes and our muscle cells produces lactic acid and carbon dioxide with the less quantity of energy. Only two molecules of ATP are produced.